All right, Facebook, God bless you. God bless you. Dr. Joyce Gilman, what a pleasure. God bless you. Good to have you. Elder Dion Gray, the Lord bless you. Put it right here, baby.
Okay.
God bless you. Good to see everybody.
I have to put in the passwords.
Okay, we'll get it all set up first.
Okay.
God bless you all. You're coming in real good. Brother Elder Felix Alexander, Mother Johnson, the Lord bless you. Hi, everybody. Hello. God bless everybody. Come on in. Come on in, saints of God. What a great joy to have you here tonight. L'Oreal, God bless you. Toshiba, God bless you. Takesha, God bless you. Beatrice, God bless you. Go ahead and start tagging. As soon as you come in, please start sharing. As soon as you come in, please start sharing. Sharing is evangelizing. Sharing is spreading the word. Sharing is spreading the word. Sharing is evangelizing. Thank you for sharing. God bless you, Kiki. Good to see you. Amen. God bless everybody. Well, it's going to be a good night tonight, saints. We were in for a special treat from the Lord. And I'm excited that you all are here. It's a blessing to have each one of you tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. We're getting our Zoom family on along with us so we can all be together. Amen. And it's going to be a great, great night. We appreciate God for everything that everybody... I need that though. I need that close. All right. Blessings, blessings, blessings. Blessings.
You only can't hear them. I turned to mute. I muted it.
No, we got to get the camera on so we hear. I got it. It's okay. Right there. All right. God bless everybody. All right. Go ahead and share as soon as you come in. Thank you for everything. As soon as you come in, share, share, and share. Sharing is evangelizing. Remember that. Sharing is spreading the word of God. And tonight we're going to be ministering a very pertinent and powerful word from the Lord. And so I want you to make sure you get all your family, all your friends, get everybody on here that you can so we can experience God together. Amen? And to my Zoom family, can you guys, you probably can't hear me. Oh, you can hear me now, right? Thumbs up. Give me thumbs up. All right. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you, Ashley. Bless you, Kayla. Bless you, Amaya. Bless you, Mother Phyllis Hill. Bless you, Evangelist Simona. Bless you, Mother Ishmael. Bless you, Sister Almost Mother Nina. Bless you, Elder Ryan Guillen. And the Lion's Den is on. God bless you. All you that are coming on, it's going to be a great night. I expect the power of God. I expect the anointing of God. I really wanted some worship tonight. I tell you, you know, I've been worshiping God just intensely, and I wanted to share that worship with you tonight. I don't know, Facebook gets so funny sometimes about how much music you play, and I didn't put it in my comments that I don't own the music, but I really, really, really encourage you guys to just take a minute and listen to some worship songs while you're quarantined. Some of my favorites here lately have been Waymaker. I'm telling you, that song has taken me through. And then You Are My Strength and the Good, Good Father. Those are three that I just have on replay. And I'm telling you, those things bring out so much joy and causing my soul just to bubble over. And so we're getting settled in tonight. Everybody's coming in. I'm excited to see everybody. All your faces look wonderful. Amen. Now, I have I'm a little crowded here, but y'all know I got my Bible because I want to hear these pages turn. I'm trying to find a space for my big old Bible. And just in case, I do have a little phone backup, but I want to read it from the Word of God tonight. And so let's pray. Tonight is our normal at Kingdom Life Ministries. Tonight would be it's been so many things. It's been Turnaround Tuesday. It's been Tuesday Night Live. It's been Bible 101. It's just our Tuesday night gathering where we have an opportunity to come together and fellowship around God's word and worship around his throne. And so many of our KLM family are joining us tonight by Zoom, some are joining us by Facebook, and all of our other friends that are here with us, God bless you and welcome to Tuesday Night Live in the quarantine cabin. Tuesday Night Live in the quarantine cabin. And so they're starting to lift some of these some of these restrictions. I want to encourage the saints, encourage my friends here. Be careful. Don't get loose and wild, because the Bible says when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come. 1 Thessalonians. You don't want to get out here and get in these crowded places with these people who are not being careful and end up having to fight a battle that you really don't want to fight. So I encourage you to be wise with how you integrate. Be wise with how you get back into society. Be wise with how you start, getting around other people. Because a lot of people are just not cautious and they're not careful. And so you don't want to be caught up in that rush back out. So take your time. Be wise. Take it slow, and be safe in Jesus' name. I am excited tonight to see all of you here. So many of you guys here already here on Facebook. I didn't get a chance to call your names one by one, but thank you each for joining us tonight. I'm happy to see all of you. Now, again, I'm a grateful person. I'm a man that's happy to be alive. As I go through my timeline, because I'm posting, trying to encourage the saints, trying to keep everybody, lifted up. You can't help but to come across so many of these posts where people have a different outcome than what I had. And every time I come across that, my heart weeps for the people who are on the other side of this testimony, who families. One of my dear friends and associates today, you all know Pastor Keels. He's the superintendent for our region. Well, Keith, like you guys know, some of you may know Pastor Keels too, and Charlotte Keels from the Unite Church in Flint. I preached there several times, and our church has fellowship with them. Well, she had to bury her father today, who is also the father of Pastor Johnson, a colleague of mine in Detroit. And so it's just, who's also Diane Bogan's, Mother Diane Bogan's brother. All those folks are family. So y'all know Madge, that's Madge's uncle. And so these things get closer and closer to us. People that we know are grieving, people that we know are saddened, even though they know in their hearts where their loved one is. Those of you who lost loved ones, that is some comfort, and we praise God for that. But it doesn't take away the pain. It's good to know in your heart that mama's with the Lord, daddy's with the Lord, but it does not erase the pain in your heart. And so let's pray tonight. We're going to pray before we get started. We're going to pray a general prayer, but I want to pray specifically for some of these families that are going through. And what I'm going to do now is, because this lighting here is hitting me right, making my face blue and carrying on. So y'all know I get real funny about all that. And so let me move this back just a little bit, Facebook family. I'll be right back with you. Let me scooch you all up to Zoom and get a little more comfortable, and then we're going to pray. I can sense, and I know some of you guys can too, some of you precious ones can too, because you have a sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. You too can sense that tonight is going to be an incredible night of shifting, an incredible night of the anointing, an incredible night of the outpour. I'm not in a rush. I'm not going to be on here a long time, but I'm not in a rush. I don't feel like I have to answer to anybody but God. I don't feel like I need to adjust what I need to say to make people understand or make it pleasing, because there's an anointing shift. And I want you to know, those of you who are aligned, and those of you who are in agreement, and those of you who are in association with what God is doing during this season on my life, I want you to know there's something heavy coming on your life tonight that's coming off of my life. There's a transfer. Even as I sit here now and look at some of your faces here on Zoom and look into this camera here on Facebook, I can feel the moving of the Holy Spirit, like running down, and I can feel the oil is moving, and I feel it shifting and going on other people. And I want you to know right now that whatever's happening in your life and whatever you're sensing in your home right now, some of you are absolutely sensing the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of God. So I just want you to stay connected and stay positioned right now, because at any moment that shift can happen. At any moment that transfer of that mantle can happen. You don't know when it's going to happen. That's why Elijah the father told Elisha the son, if you see me when I'm taken, if you stay close enough, if you follow close enough, if you're in the right place, if you are positioned, if you are aligned, if you are associated, if you are in agreement at the right time, that mantle will fall. And whenever God decides, whatever moment, whether it's 3 a.m., whether it's 6 a.m., 9 a.m., 12 a.m., 12 p.m., no matter what time, whatever time God decides to shift, that mantle will come. And you won't have to be in the same room. You won't have to be in the same state. You don't have to be in the same country. That anointing will shift onto your life. How many want the anointing to shift onto your life? How many of you guys are ready for the anointing of God? Not church, not play stuff, not la-di-da-di. I mean, you're ready for that power of the Holy Ghost to shift into your life and to arrest, hallelujah, everything that's not like God, and to destroy it. I mean, to get all those obstacles out your way and give you a clear path right into the arms of Jesus, right into the bosom of the Holy Spirit. You're ready for God to usher you out of your place of complacency. You don't like the in-between no more. You ain't playing games. It's like, God, take me to that place. I can't get there myself. I didn't move when the grace was on me. I filibustered around. I hesitated. I missed some times with you. But God, if you show your grace upon me tonight, and your mercy upon me right now, and move the obstacles out of my way so I can get into the place where you called me to be in. And if that's you tonight, I got good news for you, because God is going to do just that. He is going to hear your cry, hear your plea, rush to your aid, and bring you the great deliverance. Now, those of you who are ashamed to say you need a deliverance, then you're in the wrong place. It's the wrong life for you. But those who say, God, I have no shame, I'm not embarrassed, there are things in my life I want you to resolve for me. And when you do that for me, I'm going to run like I have never run before and do all you called me to do with a grace and an ease I never had before. Somebody shout amen. Hallelujah. It's time. It's your time. It's your season. And so it's, God is ready to do this thing in you. He's ready to do this thing for you. Amen. Somebody say amen. Somebody say amen again. And so we believe God, we trust God. We know that God is able, and we know that God will do exactly what he said that he would do. And so I am excited to share with you tonight, just tremendously excited to have this opportunity to stand with you, be with you, speak to you, prophesy to you, and knowing that God is going to answer our prayer. Amen? So let's pray and as we get prepared to share God's word. Would you bow your heads with me now and pray? Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your presence. Father, I pray right now for my brothers and my sisters, those are here on Facebook, those here that are on Zoom, my sons and daughters. I pray for the moving of the Holy Spirit to arrest every opposing force, everything that stands in their way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let it be so, let it be now. Let the moving of the Holy Spirit, the shifting of God, the movement of God, let it be upon them now. Move them from where they are to where you call them to be. Transform, translate, and transmit them into the kingdom of God. You can do it in an instant. You said in a moment, we'll be changed. It'll take you forever. So change us now in Jesus' name. And Father, we pray a special prayer for all of these hurting and grieving families. Hallelujah. I pray right now that you would cause a spirit of joy, peace, and comfort to overcome them. That they would just all of a sudden, while we're praying here on Zoom and Facebook, joining our faith together, I pray that a spirit of comfort and peace and joy would just come into their homes, just come into their hearts, reassure them that you're with them, that you're standing with them, that you can heal their hurt and heal their pain. And Father, I pray right now that there be no spirit of depression and sadness and overwhelm and extended grief, but that they would come to a place of peace and rest. And though they miss their loved ones, give them the comfort that only you can bring. I pray, Shandelabohurashata. I pray this in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. All right, I need everybody to say amen. Praying for these families. Now don't let this be the last time you pray. And the Lord told me as I was going through Facebook on this afternoon, a couple of days ago, he reminded me this afternoon, but a couple of days ago, for the first time, he said, don't pass these things by. If you're scrolling down and people still saying, I lost my mama, I lost my father, you know, my heart is, he said, don't just scroll by. Stop and comment on it. Put prayer hands up. Say something, because people are putting it out there because they want comfort. And so if they're sharing with you that very sensitive part of their heart, they're saying, help, this is hurting. And so the more of us that take out the minute that it takes us to put a love up there or write something that says we're praying for you, it helps that. I'm going to tell you what got me through my dark times. When I knew people were praying for me. You say, well, how'd you know that? I knew it because the prayers came in my room. See, y'all want to play with God. I don't. We want to confine God to a building, confine God to a religion, confine God to a system, confine God to but God cannot and will not be reduced to what you put him in. He's not a genie in a bottle. The earth cannot contain him. Space cannot contain him. The heavens of heavens cannot contain him. The Bible says God must humble himself to sit in heaven, and the earth is his footstool. We're talking about a massive being, a supreme being, a creator and maker of all things. God is everywhere. And so the Bible says in one scripture that the prayers of the saints are taken up before the Lord and put before him as a memorial. The Bible says that Cornelius' prayers and his alms came before God as a memorial. And so your prayers, when I was in that hospital, I felt the prayers were walking. The prayers were moving. The prayers was talking. The prayers was touching me in my belly. And so as we pray, we're not just, prayer knows no distance. It knows no boundaries. It knows no perimeters. It knows no prejudice. Prayer will go wherever you send it. He sent forth his word and it healed them. We can send God's word tonight to every grieving family, and we do so. We send God's word to every grieving family. We send our prayers to every grieving family, and these prayers and these words will be living spirits in their home. Your prayers came in that hospital as living spirits. Those prayers came before God. God used those prayers to send angels in my room, to use those prayers to send comfort. And here I am today because the saints pray. I'm sitting here in this seat talking on Facebook Live and Zoom because people pray. I believe in the power of prayer. And so I ask you now, every time you're on Facebook, do like I'm doing. Stop for a minute, put a comment in there. Let those folks know you're praying for them. Let them know they're not alone. They're not by themselves. And that not only is God with them, but we are with them as well. Amen? And amen. Well, Facebook, as you're coming in, you know sharing is evangelizing. Sharing is it is helping to spread the word of God. If this is blessing you, it will bless somebody else. If this is helping you, it will help somebody else. So go ahead and press that share button at every chance you get. Press that share button. Every chance you get, press that button and help me spread the word of God. Help me tell somebody else what God is doing in the earth. Because let me tell you this, beloved, even though we have this coronavirus spreading around the earth, moving from country to country, from town to town, this thing knows no distance. This thing has broken every geographical barrier ever set up. It knows no borders. It does not respect lines drawn in the sand. It affects both the rich and the poor, the elite and the commoner. Nobody is exempt and nobody can escape its grip because the anguish is among the wealthy as well as the less privileged. The anguish, you hear the cries. The ugly and strong grip of this demonic force is changing lives. It is shutting whole governments down, bringing whole nations to its knees, affecting global economies everywhere. Who have seen such a thing in our generation? Who have known of this in our generation? We are alive experiencing something that will be historical in nature, monumental in its effect. The world will be talking about this for a long time. Should God delay his coming? Should God delay his coming? The world will be talking about this time for a long time. And here we are surviving COVID-19. I wish I had me a church here tonight. I said, here we are overcoming the obstacles. Here we sit tonight, healthy on these Facebook Live, healthy on this Zoom. We ought to pause right now. We ought to pause right now and give God the kind of praise that says you are a keeper. We ought to pause right now and give God the kind of praise that says if it had not been for your protection, it could have been me on the ventilator. It could have been me in the hospital. It could have been me at Paradise Funeral Home or any other place of rest. But God, I thank you that your grace and your mercy, I touched enough things. I've been enough places. I've been around enough people to have it. Hallelujah. But you protected me. And chances are I have come in contact with someone. Chances are with 3 million people around the world affected. With almost 1 million of those people being right here in the United States. Chances are, God, I've been around that thing. Hallelujah. But a shield around me. You are a shield around me. Hallelujah. You're the glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. I'm sorry. Tonight we're going to praise him. I said tonight we're going to praise him. Tonight we're going to praise him. This is quarantine, but it's also Tuesday Night Live. It's quarantine, but it's also Bible 101. It's quarantine. Hallelujah. But we're going in because I feel the power of the Holy Spirit. And we praise you, God, for your protection. We praise you for your protection. We praise you for your protection. Remember these spalande. Woo! Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And so God is praised. God is to be praised. He is to be adored. He is to be lifted up. And so when they write the book, when they write this in the history books, and they talk of the devastation, and they talk about the catastrophic effects that this virus has brought to the world. They must include that even though there are 3 million people infected, of those 3 million people, 200 and some odd have died, which means there are at least 1.8 million people whom the Lord has brought through. Hallelujah. And I just want to say, I'm glad to be in the number. Glad to be in the number. Glad to be in the number one more time. You didn't have to let me live. Didn't have to let me live. Glad to be in the number one more time. Hallelujah. And so praise God with those who are praising God and weep with those who are weeping. That's the book. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. What a joy it is tonight to be with you. That was our praise and worship. In the words of, glory to God. In the words of Alfonso Brown, this is praise and worship. This is praise and worship. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. All right, go ahead and share. If you're coming in for the first time on Facebook and you haven't shared yet, go ahead and share. Okay, now listen, I want to try this a little bit because when you guys go on Facebook and you play that music, how long do you play it?
Want to do it on my phone or this one?
Is it ready?
It can go on this one. I just don't know the password.
I'm going to try this, y'all. If they shut me down, then we'll fix it. I'll go back in and take the music out. Okay? But I'm going to try this because this thing been in my spirit. And so I just want you guys to go with me for just a minute. Just a minute. Now, if I go in too deep, saints, y'all come get me out. Somebody.
You won't play it yet. You have to put it to the thing first.
You said it was ready.
I just wanted you to unlock it so I could put it on here.
All right. So Zavidia, Pastor Michelle, well, y'all not on Facebook. Simona, if you're on both of these, if I go out, pick it up. Pick it up and take it on in. Because this right here blesses me every morning at 3:37. Just for a moment, y'all. Just lift those hands. Yerabashaya. Hallelujah. Can you hear it? Can you hear it? You can hear it? Can you hear it on Facebook? Can you hear it? Okay, thank you, Kiki.
You are here. Girl.
God, that is who he is. That is who he is. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. We praise you. We magnify your holy name. There is no God like you in all the earth, God. We give your name all the glory. All the honor belongs to you. All the praise belongs to you. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your name. Bless your name. Bless your name, God. Hallelujah. How many know he's worthy to be praised? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. Well, saints, I tell you, God is worthy of all the praise. All the glory belongs to him. He's worthy of all the honor. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Just a little bit of this. All right. Well, saints, we're gonna get into the word. We're gonna get into the word. I am so overwhelmed by the goodness of our God, so overwhelmed by his grace and his mercy. From the book of Haggai. From the book of Haggai. Or Haggai. Haggai. Hadaba Shandiriosaya. Well, listen, I'm planning something. And it's going to be great. We're going to plan a night of worship, and there's a way to get it done where you get permission and all that. And we're just going to come together for a night of worship. It's going to be great. Get some of our own singers, get them set up on some soundtracks, and just I long to worship the Lord with the saints. I'm doing it here in my quarantine quarters. I'm sure you're doing it in your home. But it's going to be great when we can just come together and just feel the presence of God and experience the presence of God together. Tonight, I told you we would discuss the government, glory, and gold. Put that in your comment box. Put it here on the chat box. Government, glory, gold. That's what we're talking about tonight. Our minds are being changed in this quarantine. Some people are just simply quarantined, but other people are making sure and they're determined that they're going to change. I'm not just going to be quarantined. I'm going to change. And we're putting these things to practice. Whatever God is teaching us, we're putting these things to practice. We're making sure that we don't just sit here and twiddle our thumbs and wait for the time to pass. Because you really don't want the time to pass. And now that's the undertone to that. That's the play on words. You really don't want the time to pass without you maximizing on what you could be receiving during this time. And so with that in mind, the book of Haggai, verse number one. So when you have Haggai, chapter number two, and verse number one, we'll start our reading. I'm reading from my Bible here. It is the King James Version, and it's red, the red letter edition. Glory to God. And you can hear the pages turning. I see some of y'all got y'all Bibles. Come on, church. We're going back to this. The first Sunday back in, we're going to bring up with our big old Bibles. We're going to turn out. Come on, Kelly. That's right. That's right. Get that Bible. And so the word of the Lord says, in the seventh month, in the 1 20th day of the month, came the word of the Lord by the prophet Haggai, saying, speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Dodesh, the high priest, and the residue of the people, saying, very important verse, number three, listen to this. Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it, or how now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison as it is nothing? Who is left among you that saw this house in its first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing? Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, saith the Lord, and be strong, O Joshua. Be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. According to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remaineth, among you. For thus saith the Lord, for a little while, yet once, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and dry land. I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, saith the Lord. And the glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, saith the Lord. Amen. Now that is a powerful scripture, and that is a powerful verse of scripture. And so I want to focus on the topic government, glory, and gold. Amen? Government, glory, and gold. Now, excuse me if my jubilant attitude and my happiness makes you uncomfortable here on Facebook. Excuse me if you say, why are you shaking his head? Because I understand that my greatest days are ahead of me. And as opposed to knocking this computer over and knocking the iPhone over and jerking the book, and I just do this. But on the inside, I am running around this low level, screaming to the top of my lungs, because God's promise alone is enough for me. I need an amen. Where's my amen corner? Is it on Facebook or is it on Zoom? Where are my amen people? God's word is enough for me. If I got a promise from God, I can take it to the bank. Like the song just said, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. My God, I'm sleeping, you're working. I'm crying, you're working. I'm doubting, you're working. I'm fearing, you're working. I'm backing up, you're working. You never stop working to get me to the place where you have called me to be. And so your word alone is enough for me. If God said it, that settles it. I believe it. Let's get to it. He said, get ready to work, because I'm with you. My spirit remaineth with you. All right. I want to call your attention to one more verse of scripture. And look at the first chapter of Haggai. Let's read that, get a little backdrop, and then we're going to jump right into this. Look at the first chapter of Haggai. And look at verse number 2. Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, the people say, the time is not come, the time that we should build the Lord's house. The time has not come that we should build the Lord's house. The people say. First of all, let me just slow down right there. You be very careful how much you depend on, lean on, trust in, follow what the people say. Because I can attest to you unequivocally that the people don't send the anointing, that the people don't raise you up, that the people don't make a way, that the people don't open doors, the people don't drive devils out, the people don't heal your body, the people don't supply your needs. You better trust the one who is able. The Bible says, do not fear man who can destroy your body, but fear the one who can destroy both your body and your soul. So, I mean, people should not be your main focus. People should not be your main thing. Because the people say it's not time for the Lord's house to be built. Who are the people? And who authorized the people? And why are the people's voice so strong? You know, I understand we live in America and we the people. In order to form a more excellent government or what have you. But God's way is not democracy. God's way is theocracy. It's God ruling through man, putting his will and his word out there. And we become obedient and subject to his will. We don't vote. The Bible says, who's counsel God? At what time did God pick up the phone and ask you what he should do with the world? How many times you get a text message that said, hey, I'm up here. I see what's going on down there. What y'all think I should do? He said he counsels. The Bible says he counsels by the will. He moves and operates by the will of his own counsel, by the counsel of his own will, by the counsel of his own will. God sits down with himself when he got ready to make man. He said, let us make man. He called himself into counsel and just make a decision. He said, if I was hungry, you can't feed me. You don't even know what I like. He said, the cattle on a thousand hills belong to me. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So we have to learn how to respect the will of God. Now he's the father and he will talk to you. He wants to be a relationship with you. He's not a dictator where he just, you know, spits out laws and rules. And I'm not painting him like that. But in all the love that he gives us, and all the patience that he gives us, and all the kindness, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. All that, he's still God. He's still the Holy One of Israel. He's still Jehovah. He's still the terrible God of the Old Testament. He's still a God that will give you a choice. And if you choose the wrong thing, you've set your own destruction. He's not sitting up there waiting for you to mess up so he can curse you. He said, I've set before you cursings and blessings. I set both of them before you. I set before you death and life and death. I give you the choice. And so when you choose death, don't blame God. Hallelujah. When you choose curses, don't blame God. He says, you say it's not time to build the Lord's house. I'm dealing with government right now. Right now, I'm dealing with government, order, structure. That's where I am right now. I'm on point number one, government. Get it together. Most people, are you listening to me, don't want to be governed. Most people don't want to be told what to do. That's why you have a whole sector of our society, a whole group of people who have been rebelling against the stay-at-home orders. You got a whole mindset and a whole mentality that the coronavirus is a hoax. It ain't even real. The government created it. Well, let me tell you this. If the government created it, They are powerful because it had me in the critical care unit of the hospital almost for a week. So you can say it's a hoax. It's not a hoax. It was in my body. And so whoever created it is doing what it's supposed to do. It's killing people. So while you out here dancing and prancing and picketing and pushing the government to reopen and pushing all that because you don't understand. And Bishop Edgar Van put up a post on his Facebook a few days ago showing the 1921, whenever that pandemic hit in the early 1900s, it was killing all those people. He put a post up for that, and he was saying how what a shame it was that people are out. Like nothing's going on. And I said to him, I said, Bishop, some people won't get it until they literally get it. It ain't going to hit them until it actually physically hits them. And so I didn't have a relaxed attitude about it. But y'all know what I was saying. I was saying it's not going to come into my house. It's not going to come near my dwelling. I went to my uncle's funeral. I was trying to be very, very careful and do what I was supposed to do. But I went. Anna told me not. She said, Daddy, do not go. Anna told me. She said, do not go. She said, I forbid you to go to that funeral, Daddy. And I said, you know, we kind of been in a jovial way. You know, I said, well, I'm going to go. And she said, so I went, and I know exactly how I got it. I didn't shake nobody's hand. I didn't hug nobody. Certainly not kissing nobody. And I tried my best to stay away from people. But when I got on the microphone, and I reached up to pull that microphone down to my mouth. And it inadvertently touched my lip like this. And I wiped my lip off because I was touching it. And when I, not thinking and not paying attention, I'm sure at some point I did this or something. And when I got home, the next day I preached at our church, outlasting the storm. I preached from the book of Acts. Y'all remember about Paul on that ship. And he said, the ship going to get towed up, but no life will be lost. Glory to God. He said, an angel came to me last night and told me we're going to have a storm. We're going to have a crash. We're going to lose the ship, but we all going to be saved. And that week, bam, that week I went down, 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 down. And you know, I mean, the rest of the story, you can read it because the book is almost done. The book is almost done. The book is almost done. The testimony is almost done. I'm 99%, 95% finished. Come on, praise God with me. I've been down in this dungeon. Y'all better praise him. I'm telling you, thank God for your prayers. Thank God for all your contributions. We're almost there. The rest you'll read about it. But I didn't have a casual attitude, but I wasn't as careful as I could have been. Because I had quoted Psalm 91, and Psalm 91 was going to keep me. No evil shall befall me, and no plague shall come near my dwelling. No evil shall befall me, and no plague shall come near my dwelling. And so I had an attitude that, not that I was too good to get it, but I just wasn't going to get it. I'm the preacher man. I'm the prophet. They ain't coming to my house. He ain't coming to my house. Well, I went somewhere and got it. It didn't come to my house. I went to his house. Glory to God. Went down there into the hotbed. Detroit is a hotbed for it. I didn't know at the time, but it's a hotbed for that. And since that funeral, there have been that I know of personally. It may be more, but I know of personally seven preachers that was in that same building with me. Are gone. One by one. My cousin, who came from Florida to the funeral, about 3 or 4 years younger than me, gone. In the same building. So 8 people, 7 were preachers, are now gone. The bishop, P.A. Brooks, who is the overseer and the bishop of that conference center in heaven. Bishop Morton's brother, Bishop Charles Morton, gone. It don't respect who you are. And you got a whole sector of our society who don't want to be governed, who don't want to be told to get in the house and sit down. Go home, shut the door, and don't come out except for essentials. Only come out when it's necessary to come out. I'm going out. They ain't going to tell me what to do. They ain't going to have me on lockdown. And you don't understand that one person can infect 40 people. And those 40 people can infect a countless number of people. And we're trying to bring this thing on a down spiral. We're trying to stop that curve. We're trying to bring it on the other side. And people feel like, oh, I can't wait. I can't wait to May 15th. I can't wait. Babe, I'm going here. I'm going there. I'm getting my hair done. One lady said, and I don't mean to be cruel or rude here, but my daughter showed me a posting on one of these social media outlets. And it was two nurses, and they said, I just want to ask you a question. Is your hairstyle for your funeral or somebody else's? Since you're so eager to get out there, you gonna get so who you dressing up for? To go to somebody else's or to attend your own? We gotta be careful because there's a plot. I'm telling you, saints, I'm not a conspiracy theorist by no stretch of the imagination. But first of all, we're not even talking about conspiracy. We're talking about blatant, out and out genocide. They're not trying to hide what they're doing. They're doing it right in our faces. Barber shops open up. Beauty shops open up. Theaters open up. And where are they opening them up? In the same spot they won't put a testing center. Okay. We gotta cry loud. We gotta spare not. We gotta lift up our voice like a trumpet in Zion. It's time for true government. Not U.S., not European, not China, not any other great power. It's time for God's government to come into the earth. And we are the only people who can bring it, because the government shall be upon his shoulders. If Christ is the head and we are the body, we carry the government of God. Come on, somebody. If Christ is the head of the church and we're the body of Christ, the shoulders are part of the body, not the head. So if the government is upon his shoulders, it's upon the church, it's upon the ecclesia, it's upon the ecclesia, it's upon us as chosen believers to carry God's government. Where is God's government found? In his kingdom. Who has the keys? You got the keys. And it's time to turn the key and bring back government. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying it's time to build God's house. If we build God's house, we will have God's government. If we build God's house, we will have God's order. If we build God's house, we'll have God's plan. We cannot build the kingdom of Satan and expect God's kingdom to rule. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. I said, we cannot continue to pour our money, our time, our efforts, our talents, our abilities into a system that will not bring back to us any life. We had better make sure that we are building God's house. Because his house is the only house that can stand. In times like these, his house is the only house that can offer direction, that can offer peace. Where can we go to find help? When the scientists and the researchers and the top medical professionals are scrambling, trying to figure out no vaccine, no cure. When the most powerful country or nation in the world, America boasts itself as the most powerful nation. Yet, 55,000 plus people have died while this powerful nation sits and haggles between parties. While they use this time as a time to campaign, as they use this time to point their finger, the Democrats did this, no, the Republicans did this, well, it's them that did it, well, it's the last administration. People are dying. 55,000 of your citizens are dead, which means there's 55,000 families crying. And each family has two sides to it, most of them. So 110,000 families, one on mama's side, one on dad's side, are crying and weeping over their dead while you get on television and filibust. And you call yourself the most powerful nation in the world when China built hospitals almost overnight, healed their sick almost overnight. And you want to point your finger and say it started there. You know it didn't start there. You know there's something bigger and more sinister going on. That's why we must get back to God's government. And God's government is simple. It's based on love. If you loved us, you wouldn't do this to us. If love was a part of the equation, you wouldn't treat people like this. You wouldn't make sure that all your testing centers are in urban, suburban communities where the white upper class and middle class people have access, where you have your people who built this country, who are the frontline workers, dying every day. And you refuse to give them services. And you know where they are. You know they don't have cars because you don't pay them enough to afford a car. They're working at these grocery stores and working at these convenience stores. And you won't even give them masks and gloves. You're fighting with whose job is it? Is it the federal government or is it the state? The state should do it. Yet you send out these, y'all, I'm going to preach. They may take it down, but I'm going to preach. You send out these peanuts in a stimulus check. And you send a letter and sign the letter personally. It's a ploy. Like, I gave you $1,000, but my mama dead. I gave you $1,200, but my son is on life support. Government cannot be our help. Earthly government cannot be our resource. We must have a government. And that is the government of God's kingdom. We must have a government driven by love, supported by love, held up by love. Am I preaching or am I preaching? So God said, what are you talking about? It ain't time to build my house. If you don't build my house, you got to trust them. If you don't build my house, you got to lean on them. But if you go back to Malachi, chapter number 3. Oh, yeah. I don't believe in all this tithing. Tithing is Old Testament. Tithing is a trick. But you'll give your taxes to a government that won't give you a mask. You'll give your taxes to a government that won't give you gloves. You'll give your taxes to a government that lets your children die in the streets. Yet you won't give your 10% to a God who's protecting you. Without a mask, who's keeping you without gloves. Y'all better help me preach in this place tonight. I feel an anointing to tear some things down. I feel the power of God and the authority of the Holy Ghost. And I'm not ashamed to preach this thing on Facebook and on Zoom. That's right. Share. Let everybody see what I said. Share it. Hallelujah. It's time to speak up. There's a government that if we build it, it can help us. There's a government, if we build it, it can save us. We could have our own banks, y'all, by now. We could have our own banks by now. Our own medical facilities by now. We have enough people in the medical field. We could take care of our own people. But we keep sowing our money into a government that won't sow back into us. To a system that won't sow back into us. And you're not going to throw some pennies at me and make me feel like you're the best president in the world. Or you're the best administration. I'm sorry, I'm not against Donald Trump because God raised up one and bring down another. That's God's business. Who's ever there is God's business. He establishes authorities. That's his business. I'm not here to bash the president or his administration. I'm saying you're not going to throw a couple bucks at me and make me forget all the trouble. Now, if you want to throw something at me, give me them 40 acres and a mule. You want to throw stuff? Throw me some land. Come on, church. Throw me some mineral rights. Throw me some oil rights. Give me a diamond mine or a platinum mine. I'm not going to clap my hands like a little monkey because you sent me $100. Not going to happen. Church, hear the prophet tonight. You got to make sure you build God's house. It's time to build God's house. Stop robbing God. Stop taking from God. Stop stealing from God. And bring ye all the tithe and the offerings into the storehouse. We are, thank God for our partnership with the food bank. But if we didn't have a partnership with the food bank, I promise you, we would have took care of our people. Whatever we have, we take care of our people. Because that's the heart of God. We can't sit on a blessing. He that hath and shut up his bowels of compassion, how dwelleth the love of God in him? Our government compels us to love. This government tells us that the only way to get to God is to love. that all the commandments are fulfilled in these two. Love the Lord your God with your whole heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love is everything to us. It's all that we are. It's all that we have. This is God's government. Come on, church. Help me preach tonight. I said, help me preach tonight, church. We're standing at a crossroad. We're standing at a fork in the road. It's decision time. These are defining times. We are standing in a time where we can make a decision. When this epidemic or pandemic is over, are we going back to business as usual? Or are we going to be wise this time and go back to Malachi chapter 3 and say, I'm not putting my money only in the government. Jesus said like this. Jesus said, give Caesar what belongs to Caesar. But you better not forget to give God what belongs to God. At that time, they had to bring their tribute. Now they take it out before you get it. You sign them papers. And when you get your check, you already see them deductions. They don't trust you. They don't trust you. They take that tax before you get it. Because they know they're going to chase you down, run you down, collect from you, put you in collection agencies, mess up your credit, knock on your door, send you letters. They ain't trusting you. So you before you see it, they take it. God at least trusts you. He said, just go ahead. I will trust you. Bring me what's mine. Because I have a greater responsibility than America. I have a greater responsibility than your government. I must take care of all my people. So bring me what I told you to bring me so I can bless it. So I can multiply it. So I can increase it. So I can cause it to be more. You bring that to me, I'm going to blow on it and bless it and increase it. And give you more, because the more I bless you, the more you're going to bless the house. The more I bless you, the more you build my house. I can't expect you to build my house and I break you. I'm not like the government and man. Am I preaching too long here? Hallelujah. I feel the power. I feel an anointing to obey God. Thank you, Jesus. He says, I want you to not hear what the people are saying. They're saying, it's not time to build God. You better do stuff for yourself. How much you giving in tithe? You better stop that. You got kids. The people say, I'm right here, y'all. In case you want to know where the prophet is, I'm right here. I'm right here in verse 2. Y'all see? I'm right there in verse 2. That's where I am. Sorry. Y'all lost me for a minute. What's the last thing y'all heard? That's where I am? You been gone for a while? Y'all been going for a while? About 2 minutes? I'm going to say it again. Y'all were here twice because they got muted. I got to tell you this. He said, I want you, don't hear the people. It's time to build my house. It's time to, the government won't even trust you. Did y'all hear that part? Y'all heard that part? But God trusts you enough? Y'all heard that part? Well, that's basically what I was saying. Over and over again. Hallelujah. You gotta, and he says, the people tell you, I know what y'all didn't hear this part. Y'all didn't hear me say, child, you better stop giving all that money. You got kids. Y'all ain't hear that, did y'all? Y'all heard that part? Then you heard everything. You right on time. You right on time. My God, I feel the Holy Ghost tonight. If I was you, I wouldn't be giving all that money. If I was you, I would be saving that. You gotta say that. He said, but you ain't holding from the government because you scared about going to jail. You scared about getting audited. You scared. You more afraid of the government of the United States of America than you are of Jehovah. Jehovah told you 10%. They tell you sometimes 33%, depending on your income bracket. They snatching stuff. I pay 33%. It depends on where you are. But thank God. Well, we ain't gonna tell all our blessings. We just gonna say God is a high five God. That's all we're gonna say. He's a high five God. That's all we're gonna say. That's all we're gonna say about that. He's a high five. He gave me a high five. Praise his name. Hallelujah. He extended my time. Praise God. Listen, church, this is serious. You've got to make sure we're building God's house, because people will tell you it ain't time to build God's house. Why are you doing all that? How much you get? Why are you doing all that? That's right, Claudia. It's a blessing to give. Hallelujah. Now watch this. He says, then the word, verse number 3, then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye who dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Right there, verse 3. Are y'all there? Verse 3. Come on now. The word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye who dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? How can you be comfortable in your house, he's saying, and God's house is in a mess? And when you're, watch this. This is the funny thing. And then I got to move on to the glory, right? And the goal. Let me get off of it, because this government thing done took me. But we did have praise and worship and all that. So we had full church tonight. Glory to God. Now, this is the part that gets me. We will seal our houses, fix our houses up, leave God's house in a mess. And as soon as our house gets in a mess, who we call? Who we call? We done left his house with nothing. We done robbed his house, hijacked his house for our house. And when our house fall apart, Lord, you said your word. He said, yeah, I did. I said Malachi 3. That's what I said in my word. What's next? Didn't I say it? Didn't I say it in Proverbs 3? Didn't I say it in Proverbs 6? Didn't I say the first fruit of your increase belongs to me? And then I'll cause your barns to overflow and your wine press to burst forth with new wine? Didn't I say it? Not what you want to say. I was just going to say you said that you was going to keep your promise to 1,000 generations. You said that you was going to bless me the city and the field, and by going out and by coming in, and you had said that every day I touch, I'm going to be blessed, because you had said that you were my rear guard and my front guard. You had said you was my shield and my buckler. He said, I was talking to tithers. Preach, preacher. Preach. I was talking to givers. I was talking to faithful ones. I was talking to those who obey my word. I said, if you obey all I command you, that same scripture you just quoted, it said, if ye observe to do all I command you this day, then thou shalt be blessed in the city and blessed in the field. Bring ye all the tithe and the offering into my house, that there is meat in my house, and prove me herewith. And see, when I open up the window, I'm prophesying right now to every tither on here, every giver on here, God is opening the windows of heaven and making sure that a blessing hits your house. When I tell you in the coming days, the windows of heaven are going to flood your house. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Open up your cabinets, open up your doors, open up your coffers. God is going to fill your house with blessing. He is not a man that he should lie. Neither the son of man he should repent. Your hungry and scraping days are behind you. It's time to move on. Somebody clap your hands and give God praise in the Holy Ghost. Watch this. He said, now therefore saith the Lord. I got to hurry up. Consider your ways. I'm on verse 5. Consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you're not filled. You're clothed, but there is no warmth. And he that earneth wages, put it into a bag with holes. Thus saith the Lord, consider your ways. Go up to the mountain, bring wood, and build the house. And I'll take pleasure in it. You look for much, but you get little. I will blow upon it, saith the Lord. Because mine house is in waste, and you run every man to his own house. We don't have proper government, no glory comes. Somebody say, no government, no glory. Come on, say it again. No government, no glory. If you don't get things in order and put first things first, you cannot experience the glory of God. If you're ready to experience the glory of God during this pandemic, if you're ready to experience the grace of God during this epidemic, if you're ready to experience the power of God during this crisis, I want you to put things in order. Get your house in order. Put first things first. The Bible says in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all the stuff you saving up for, all the stuff you pinching for, all the stuff you hide money for, I'll add that unto you. I'll cause men to give. Luke 6, 36 and 37, give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Baby, God will bless you with more than you can ever work for. I said, God will bless you with more than you can ever work for. This is the time to get in order. Now, the second phase. And now, these last two, I got to move fast, y'all. I got to move fast. I spent a lot of time on government. And why did I spend a lot of time on government? Because without government, there can be no glory. And without glory, there can be no gold. It's first government, and that brings the glory of God. Because you'll notice, beloved, that this is the first chapter of Haggai. In the very second chapter, he says to them about the house. Remember, because it's in ruins. He just told you it's in ruins. He said, you left my house in a mess. Your house is all tight. I just thank the Lord I was able to furnish my whole house. I thank the Lord I was able to buy new furniture, and I ain't have to get nothing from Rent a Center. Hallelujah. And we say, we got to fix our parking lot. We got to put a roof on the church, and we want to do a cast. But how can you testify in God's house and it's raining about how your house is tight? How can you say, the Lord blessed me to do A, B, and C, and his house falling apart? You in his house then. I just praise God because, saints, the Lord blessed me. I just had my whole everything redone. Praise the Lord. No praise, nothing. Put a roof on God's house. And don't be pledging and not showing up. Y'all not talking back to the preacher tonight. But it's okay. It's okay. He says, now watch this. If you get it in order, and you put my government back in order, if you free the man of God up from worrying about finances, if you let me work through the woman of God creatively, because I chose creative people. I gave them gifts. I gave them talents. I gave them abilities, and I gave them an anointing. And if you will free them up from being worried and concerned about what you're supposed to do, then they can implement and birth out the kind of programs, ideas, concepts that will bring in an overflow for your life. You don't want your ox muzzled. The ox can't be muzzled and tread the corn. You don't want to take out your beast that helps you break up the fallow ground and get your harvest ready. Get your land ready for a seed for the harvest. You don't want to cripple that person, that beast. Paul said, if the ox gets fed, then make sure you feed your woman of God, your man of God. Don't be jealous and be like, I can't believe that. I ain't giving up. What? Every time you have a chance to give into your man and woman of God, you do that. And forget what your mama talking about. Y'all quiet now. My sister said, preachers be taking money. Who is your sister? Who is your sister? Oh, y'all don't want me to preach tonight. Oh, I know who your sister is. She the same one won't loan you $5. That sister. The one who you call and say, I need help. She said, well, I got to help myself. That sister, I would listen to her. Y'all don't want the man to preach. Now, in the very next chapter, chapter number 2. Hallelujah. He says, how do you see this house? You've been here for a while. What you think about what's going on? Don't it look like it ain't nothing to you? I'm gonna tell you right now. I'm not ashamed to say this, and I'll hold this for after our post Zoom church meeting. We say hi to each other. If y'all remind me, I'm gonna write it down right now. I'm not gonna say this on Facebook, but I'm gonna say it to my sons and daughters. Give me 1 second to write it down. Okay, you guys remind me, I'm going to grab that piece of paper when we're done, and I'll tell you what's on it. But remind me, you want to hear that. Trust me. He said, how you see it now? Don't look like it ain't nothing to you? He said, but I want you to know that if you'll do what chapter 1 says, if you'll go get the wood and fix my house up, if you'll go get the things that I told you, the cedar, and the Lebanon, and you'll bring all this stuff from the mountain. He said, I'll take pleasure in it. Fix it up. I'll take pleasure. He said, and when I do, I want you to know that the glory of the Lord will come on this house. And the ladder of it, do you remember how it was before? Wasn't it great? Wasn't it grand? Wasn't it powerful? Wasn't the Spirit of the Lord moving in a mighty way? Wasn't we taking the Michigan region by storm? Wasn't we driving up and down the freeway? Wasn't we going from Flint to Saginaw, from Saginaw to Flint? Wasn't we seeing growth? Didn't we see expansion? He said, I want to let you know, if you'll do what I'm telling you to do, get my house back in order, the latter of this shall be greater than what you saw. I'm going to blow your mind. I'm going to send my anointing in there. I'm going to send my power in there. Listen, y'all, we're right here in chapter number 2. He said, according to the covenant that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, my spirit remaineth among you. Do not fear. I'm going to shake the nations. I'm going to shake the heavens and the earth. But then I'm going to fill this house, verse 7, with glory. And then he said, "This is we get ready to close. Verse 8 said, the silver is mine. And the what? And the what, y'all? Come on, I hear you, Simona. And the what? And the gold. So the government brings the glory, and the glory brings the gold. You want to really be blessed as a church? You want your ministry blessed, pastor who's watching me right now? You can't comment because you're not a friend, but I know you're watching because God said you're watching. You want that church to explode? Then get back to government and watch the glory of God come. And when God's glory comes, the next thing that follows God's glory is the gold. It belongs to him. He said, the devil ain't got your money. I do. Uh-oh. Ooh, these folks quiet on me tonight. He said, the devil ain't doing this. I'm blowing on your money because you ain't taking care of my house. You are out of order. Your house ain't in order. He said, but the moment you get it in order, the silver that you need, it's mine. The gold that you need, it's mine. And I will release silver and release gold, and the ships of Tarshish shall back up into your borders, and the Gentile ships shall come into your borders, and those that have the wealth will come in your borders, and I will command them to release wealth upon you. This is the greatest wealth transfer we have ever seen. Let me say, you get that stimulus check, don't you dare go crazy. Sow a seed out that check and save some. Ask God to lead you to the right investment. Take that money and do something. Don't just spend it. I'm going to catch up on all my stuff. No, 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 no. Slow your roll. Slow your roll. Slow your roll. Slow your roll. Be wise. Make sure you take a portion and you sow. Take a portion and you save. And then you spend. Sow, save, and spend. Be smart, because if you have a little bit, he that hath, it shall be given. He that hath not, it shall be taken away. Let me tell you something. Saints, my children, my sons, my daughters, I'm full. Oh, I have so much I want to share with you. The wisdom of the matter, is that I must learn to be disciplined in my finances so God can trust me with the gold. Somebody lift those hands right now and say, Lord, teach me wisdom so you can trust me with the gold. Lord, teach me government so I can get the glory and bring the gold. God wants to trust you with more. How many of y'all believe that God wants to trust you with more? God wants to trust you with more. He wants to trust you with more. He said, tell my people tonight, the government brings the glory, and the glory brings the gold. And then watch this. Are you listening to the pastor tonight? And then the glory brings more government. I mean the gold. I'm sorry. It's a cycle. The government brings the glory. The glory brings the gold, and the gold brings more government. How? Because now I can hire people. When gold comes in the house, I can hire people. I can get me a secretary. I can get me an administrator. I can get me an accountant. I can get me a lawyer. I can. See, when gold comes in, I can set myself up. I start out with my own little bit. I start out with putting my house in order, getting my tithing record right, getting my giving record right. And then God blessed me with the glory. It brings more gold. Now I can say, listen, I got a job for you. And I can structure more. And the next thing you know, I'm a conglomerate. Pastor Michelle, I am of myself a conglomerate. In me lies enough resources. Come on, prophesy right now. In me lies enough resources to take care of me and generations behind me. One more time. In me lies enough resources to care for myself and for future generations. I'm smart enough. I'm anointed enough. I'm talented enough. I'm gifted enough. I'm too gifted to be broke. Woo! Preach! I'm too intelligent to be broke. I'm too creative to be broke. There's too many things I can do. I'm watching this child sitting on here right now. Someone watch you in church. I'm not rebuking you. I'm celebrating you. But next time, don't be someone in church. But right now, I'm celebrating you. Being industrious. Getting these masks sitting out across the country. She's selling across state lines. Too talented. You ain't got to be broke because McDonald's ain't your future. You better hear what I'm talking to you. That's just temporary. You're too anointed to be behind somebody else's counter making them rich. Stay focused. God's going to bless you in a major way. Government brings what? Glory brings what? Tara shitala bahande. Hallelujah. Government brings what? Glory. Glory brings what? Gold. Gold brings what? More government. More glory, more gold. More government, more glory, more gold. We're about to go into the cycle. I call it 3G. I'm going into the 3G cycle. I'm going to the 3G cycle. Come on, say it on here. I'm going into the 3G cycle. Now we get ready to sow tonight. And we're sowing to KLM. I want you to get ready to get a 3-0 seed in your hand, $30. All of our tithers, you tithe the way you're supposed to tithe. I do apologize. I didn't go with Switcher tonight, and I should have because they could have put the information up on the screen. For those who don't know, all my Rochelle, you guys hurry up, put up this hashtag KLM or CCB, put all that information up so they can know how to sow tonight. Because the Lord told me, He said, tell the people that a $30 seed tonight going into the ground, the fertile ground that I'm preaching on, is going to bring the 3G anointing into your life. Now, once you sow that seed, don't just sow it and cross your fingers and hope things get better. Go put your house in order. Listen to the prophet. Don't just sow some money thinking miraculously your whole life is going to turn around. It's a part of it. Sowing is a part of it. But you got to make sure at your local church, tithe to your local church. Kingdom Life Ministers, you all know what we teach and believe. I haven't talked to this hard in a while. But if I don't get you blessed, our church ain't going to be blessed. I got to get you into the blessed season. I got to get you into the 3G anointing. Amen. Tithe to your local church. Be faithful and give. Set your own little business and stuff in order. Get your stuff ready. Get it lined up. Don't be sloppy. Don't be raggedy in your business. And God's going to bless it with the glory of God. Whatever you put into divine government, He's going to bless that. God's house first. Can I get an amen on that? God's house, my house. God's house, my house. God's house, my house. Right now, I want you to make up in your mind you're going to sow it. I want all of KLM to do it. Wherever you get it from, get it. And let's sow. Tonight, we're going to make sure that KLM sows for your own house and for God's house. All right? I want your house blessed, but we also want to sow for our ministry to go to the next level. It's time for our ministry. Oh, okay. I'm going to put this down too because when we have our little short meeting, it's going to be, because listen, Pastor been fasting all day, okay? I mean, and that's what I do, I fast. I fast and pray so my flesh know you didn't get healed for yourself. So I'm going to eat tonight. And I'm eating a salad, but I'm going to eat. So we're not going to be on, how long are we going to be on that? Short, very short. I'm writing a note down for you, saints. right. That's my last pastoral note for you. All right. So I want you to go ahead and sow. Put up the $KLM Saginaw. $KLM Saginaw. Also, you can go to our website, myklife.org. myklife.org. You can give that way as well. That's all our ways, right, Rochelle? Give me a thumbs up. That's the two ways they can give tonight. They can give myklife.org. They can give through Cash App at $KLM Saginaw. All right? If you want to sow to the man of God's life, that's cash, that's $Alvernis, A-L-V-E-R-N-I-S. I'm not asking you to do that. I'm not begging. I'm just saying if you want to sow that way, you can do that way too. All right? Do what you're going to do. Do what you're going to do. Do it quickly. All of our tithers, Father, I thank you for every tither. Those who have dedicated the holy thing unto you, it's because of their faithfulness to sow and to give their tithe that we're able to complete the mandate of ministry you've given to us. So I've caused the blessing of Malachi 3 to be in their house. Rebuke every devourer and cause their storehouses to be filled. Give them new ideas, new ways, new inventions, new concepts, new streams of income. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen and amen. Well, Facebook, I love you guys. These quarantine check-ins, I'm gonna miss y'all when this is over. I'm gonna miss you, but I promise you, I'm gonna come on at least once or twice a week. I'll keep up with you, but it won't be every day like it's been here. But I'm not gonna promise that. But the book is coming out real soon. I'm in my final stages of the book. The testimony. It's not a novel. It's not a fiction. It's not a self-help book. It's a testimony. And saints, I know it's gonna bless many, many people. We are so excited. We are so excited because we get to bless some hospitals. We get to bless some healthcare workers. We get to bless some families that are trying to bury their loved ones. The finances that we're going to use, the pastors I reached out to have been wonderful to help. And so it's going to be really a big, big deal. Believe in God for a news story. All the publicity that we can get. And you here on Facebook, you're going to be my helpers. All right? You'll be my ambassadors and my spokesmen. All right. I can't wait to share with you the plan that we have to get the word out about surviving COVID-19 from virus to victory. Somebody shout amen. All right. I'm going to say goodnight to my Facebook family, all of my Kingdom Life family that's on here that can get on Zoom. Jump on Zoom real quick. Our administrator will make sure you get in as fast as possible. I'm going to give you a little short post-service talk, and then we're going to move on. Thursday. If you're in the Saginaw area, Thursday from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m., we're going to be giving out free food boxes for children and families. So you can come. Sunday we gave out, I think it was, when I left, it was 300 and some meals. It may be a larger number now. I think Javita is trying to put that together for me. She's probably going to put it up so I can see it. But I know when I left, there were over 300 meals distributed on Sunday, which is a great blessing. And so we thank God for that and for the ability to do so. Excuse me. Excuse me. Javita, are you giving me a number? What you doing? You're looking real busy there. Should I be waiting on you? I can't hear you. They have to unmute you. Can you unmute Javita? I can't hear you. 472 meals. Come on, y'all. Can we just praise God? 472 meals on this past Sunday. All right? So I want you guys, if you're in the Saginaw area and you need or desire a little help, sometimes you just need a little boost. And there's nothing to be ashamed of. God has made a way for you. So come by the church on this Thursday from 1 to 3, and also on Sunday from 1 to 3. And we'll be happy to serve you. All right, Facebook, I will see you tomorrow for quarantine cabin check-in at 7. All right? I'm going to say goodnight to you. All my KLM family, meet me on Zoom in just a moment. All right? God bless you. Have a great night, everybody.